What's up, everybody? My name is Grant Cox, and I am the chairman of the VEX Robotics Game Design Committee. I'm standing here with the game for 2023-2024, VRC Over Under. We're going to take a closer look at some of the field elements, the game elements, answer some of the questions that you might have as you explore this new game. We are releasing these videos pretty much as the new game gets released. We release a series of updates to the manual throughout the season. So if anything changes over the course of the season that isn't consistent with something you see in this video, just remember, the current version of the game manual always takes precedent over all other support materials. So let's get started. First up, let's take a look at these game objects. They are called tri-balls. They are kind of a weird shape. This shape is referred to as a rouleau triangle or a rouleau tetrahedron. They are hard plastic, hollow, pretty lightweight, lighter than they look. Should be an interesting challenge for robots to manipulate. They have some interesting properties in the ways that they roll. Even though a robot would probably manipulate it somewhat similarly to the way you would manipulate a ball, they do roll in kind of unexpected ways. Kind of warbles around. It's also very unpredictable if you toss them or launch them, how they will react. It's kind of like an American football in that manner. It might shift off to the side, might bounce. So teams will have to definitely work on the best way to prototype that and figure out the best ways to play. As with all games, the tri-balls do start in predetermined places on the field. Rotation of those tri-balls is not specified, so it doesn't matter if it's rotated slightly off to the side or not. We do have red and green tri-balls in the same game here. Red-green colorblindness is a common form of colorblindness that is found out there. So one of the things that we are recommending, if event partners choose to do so, they can actually place dots or Sharpie in the corners of the red tri-balls to help differentiate red from green. We'll release more information about this in an actual game manual update later on in the season, but just wanted to give you a heads up on that. One of the things that's pretty unique about Over Under is how many match loads there are. You get to match load more game objects than start on the field. So objects that are match loaded have to follow the rules in SG6. It's pretty straightforward. Basically just means place the match load into the match load zone. Don't throw it, don't try and bounce past it. One interesting note, and again, this is found in SG6, the definition of match load zone refers specifically to the gray foam tile, the portion of the gray foam tile that's contained in this corner here. So it is perfectly legal to place multiple objects in the match load zone as long as they all satisfy that definition of being in the match load zone or contacting the gray foam tile. So what that means is you can keep loading up the foam tile with as many as you want until you reach a point where it can't touch the foam tile anymore. Next up, let's take a look at the field element that really makes this game possible, the goals. So obviously there's one goal on each side of the field, one red and one blue. The goals are made of mostly PVC structure with, you know, this netted portion on the top. One thing that was really common question when the game came out was how do the tri-balls actually interact with the goal? How do you get them into the goal? Yes, the tri-ball is slightly higher, slightly larger diameter than the distance from the goal to the foam tile. So you do have to actually shove it under the goal slightly in order to score it. Simply tossing the tri-ball from afar or trying to like get it in that way usually won't work. You're gonna need to be pretty much on top of the goal in order to shove it in. We've done a significant amount of testing with these goals using super heavyweight robots and robots smashing into them 1,000 times and whatnot. Yes, it is thin PVC, but it should withstand most wear and tear during a normal season. The one piece of advice we would have about storing these goals or transporting them from event to event, if they're going to be stored in a hot car or a, you know, warehouse or closet or something, just make sure that nothing heavy is like pressing down on them or, you know, that there's no chance of them sagging or anything like that. Another interesting thing about feature about these goals, you saw me do it a couple times there just previously. At the end of the match, once you have objects inside the goal and it's time for field reset, the goal does actually lift up from the side of the field. So field resetters or referees can reach in and remove the objects. Of course, SG5 states that you're not allowed to do that during a match. So yes, even though technically you can try and sneak a tri-ball in through the side, just don't even try it. It won't be legal during gameplay. If you think you found a way to do it, we'll probably make it not legal. Another really common question with this game is, hey, this net looks like a big springboard. What happens if objects land on top of the net? Well, in most cases, they're gonna bounce back off. Or in most cases, they're gonna land and maybe roll off. If you do end up in the situation where a try ball comes to rest on top of a goal or on top of the net during a match, then the note in SG3 states that the alliance who is lined up where I'm standing right now, so in this case it would be the red alliance, they are able to reach in, take it, and then use it as a normal match load. So don't recommend if you're the blue alliance, you know, getting too many try balls stuck up on top of there because you're essentially giving them to your opponent. One other quick note about storage and transport. The goal can be kept mostly intact for storage or for teardown and storage. What we recommend is basically removing it from the wall here, removing it from the steel plates underneath, and then you'll be able to essentially fold the netted portion in line with these PVC pipes. You can zip tie it together and you kind of get this nice L-shaped structure. The two nets can then sandwich together and you're good to go for storage. The most critical element, of course, is what is considered scored in the goal. Your most basic definition, if the try ball's in the goal, obviously that counts as scored. For edge case scenarios, such as where the try ball is right up against the lip of it at the end of a match, or just barely, you know, stuck under the PVC pipe, the rules state that the way to identify scored versus not scored is to check the corners of the try ball. In order to be considered scored, you need a minimum of two corners inside the net, the goal structure. So for example, right here, not scored, not scored. Now at this point, even though the try ball is mostly outside of the goal, or it appears mostly outside of the goal, I can tell from looking straight down on it, which is what a head referee will do, that these bottom two corners are actually inside the goal, within the vertical plane of the outside of the goal. So this try ball right now is considered scored. Similarly, as soon as you basically are able to get that moment of shoving the top corner underneath the edge of the PVC, it's pretty much always going to be considered scored no matter how the rotation ends up. So the best way to ensure that your objects can't accidentally be descored or anything of that nature is to make sure you get that actual shove under the PVC pipe. Of course, everyone's favorite part of over-under, myself included, the field includes this huge PVC barrier all the way across the whole field. The barrier is made of 2-inch PVC, 2-inch nominal PVC. It's pretty straightforward to assemble. It's just these screws that go straight through the pipes into our plastic connectors all the way around. Quick note on assembly and teardown of the barrier. The instructions essentially has you build the barrier in two halves and then bring it together in the middle of the field on the field. For tearing it down, you're gonna wanna do the same thing. You're gonna wanna disassemble the center point first and then take it apart and then go from there. If you try to lift up the whole barrier while it's still attached, that center connector might not make the journey with you. Another point about assembling the barrier to the field or connecting the barrier to the field, there are two sets of instructions for both the goals and the barriers, depending on whether you're using the old metal field perimeters or the new portable field perimeters. Obviously, we have the portable field perimeter here. The instructions are mostly the same. The only difference is that some of the hardware, some of the screws that go through the sides of the field are slightly different lengths. So make sure you're using the correct instructions. The only other note, if you are using the portable field perimeter, getting your GPS strip lined up in the correct orientation is absolutely key. On the barrier itself, this PVC obviously held down to the floor through these multiple steel plates underneath. It does have this yellow cap at the top of it. As you've all seen in the rules by this point, hopefully, elevations do not count if you're touching the yellow cap. This yellow cap can come off, so head referees or field resetters, just make sure that that is secured after every match, especially after a match that maybe has a particularly intense elevation process. Elevations are measured using the measuring stick.
Wow.
Every field kit comes with one of these measuring sticks, and it's a pretty simple piece of PVC. The exact dimensions for the gradients are located in Appendix A if you, for some reason, need to make your own or you lose yours or something. Measuring robots is pretty simple. You place the measuring stick on the field and visually check where the lowest point of the robot reaches on the measuring stick. A couple interesting things to note on the measuring stick. Elevation tier A does go about a finger's width above the black barrier. So if your robot is able to rest on the black barrier, that will get credit for being in elevation tier A. The other one to note is the difference between D and E. This marker between D and E is a little bit above the horizontal elevation bar. So that means that in order to reach tier E, you need to prove that no part of your robot is touching the horizontal elevation bar. I hope you enjoyed this opportunity to take a closer look at the VRC Over Under field. I cannot wait to see what you all come up with to play this game. So if you have further questions about the game or something we might have gotten wrong in the initial version of the manual, be sure to log into robotevents.com with your team account and post on the official Q&A there. That's about all I got, so good luck and have a great season.